Alrighty, guys, welcome here to Town Hall Heroes, episode number 87. My name is Solid Jake, and this week we are joined by Aethera Angel, McIntyre, Kubi, and Zoya. Let me give them the power to talk. What's up, guys? Did it the wrong button?
Hello.
There we go.
Hello.
Nice. Welcome. Alright, so let's just go down the line. Pharaoh, you were on the BlizzCon live episode, but this is your first time on a normal episode. So why don't you just do a full introduction?
I'm the warrior player for Dignitas, who was formerly Bob, went to BlizzCon, came second, got crushed by Cloud9, and yeah, I'm here.
All right, McIntyre, you have been on the show, but it's been quite some time. So why don't you give introductions as well?
Yeah, McIntyre. I currently play for Team Bob Ross Fan Club. I'm a melee assassin player. I was a previous Complexity team player. Yeah, I don't know. Getting back into the scene. Had like a 3-month break, but I'm excited to play Heroes again, especially, I guess, with the new season starting up. So, yep, that's about it.
Kubus Maximus.
Had a interesting weekend. Didn't do any video game stuff at all. Just was in Boston with my girlfriend. It was her birthday, so we flew her over here. Other than that, just really busy. We were talking during the pre-show, saw some movies and stuff. Fun, but very little hero stuff. Was able to catch up on the games, but really quiet for me.
Zoya. You're muted,
super
bro.
Super muted, boys.
Hello. just tryouts, man. Still going through the motions. I think they're going okay so far. We're finding a few gems here and there that the NA talent pool's not. Maybe they're aware of, just, or maybe they're not. I don't know. But we're getting some good players. Aside of that, did a bit of Overwatch casting this weekend, and it was okay. The game's definitely got a good ways to go. I know people were like, well, it launched with this, and Heroes doesn't even have that, but it still has a way to go. So, I don't know. It was a good experience, though.
Nice. Well, here on episode 87, we're going to be talking about a lot of the EU roster changes in preparation for DreamHack Winter 2015, which will be also a big topic for tonight. Patch thoughts first week. Obviously, the new Battleground is out, and we've been playing Cho'Gall for a week, so we're going to talk about the scaling changes and just better impressions on all that stuff. And then Bob Ross Fan Club, a new team that's taking the NA scene by storm. And some updates on Gold League. Cloud9 has been playing in China. We're going to give you guys the rundown as to exactly what's happening over there and how they're doing. But to start out the show, let's talk about some of these EU roster changes. And Aethera, obviously, you're Dignitas. Dignitas has a new roster, which people could say is a dream team in a lot of ways. You guys just had a big swap. You traded one player for two. How does that work?
Yeah. So when we got back from BlizzCon, we said that we wanted to make roster changes. It took us about 2 weeks, roughly, to actually get the roster changes to happen, even though we know what we wanted to do for, like, since we got back from BlizzCon. And pretty much what we did is we traded like one for one with Na'Vi and then a sum of money for the other player, which I cannot say, obviously.
Oh, that's really cool, though. I think that's the first time that's
happened. That's more details than I even expected to get. That's really, really interesting. Cool.
I mean, like, that's the type of thing that happens all the time, I would imagine, with like League and Dota, where there's salaries, they buy out salaries, and it's essentially trading some kind of salary for players. That's cool.
So what's the deal with ADRD?
Going in there.
Yeah, asking the hard questions. Like, did he leave? Was he removed? Does he have a new team?
All right, so before I say anything, right?
Okay.
I'm not going to go as ham as what Zoya would go. What I will say is what I'm about to say should not affect, like, anyone that wants to approach him in joining their team, because he's still a very good player, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, he could fit with another team. But the thing is, the problem, like, the problems we had was obviously very clear at BlizzCon when we were speaking to like you guys. We weren't happy playing together. Like, it was sort of like Tempo Storm, but not as bad. And then, like, all the way through Prague and just after Prague. And then after, when we got to BlizzCon and we started, like, losing some games, it literally got, like, to the point of we didn't want to play together. Like, some of the players just did not want to play, like, practice together. But we wanted to practice because, you know, it's BlizzCon, right? And the issue was, is, I don't want to say the cliched word of personality clashes, but that's the lightest term I can use without going Zoya Ham. Okay?
You can see the salt in his face. I love it. All right. So, trying to keep things relatively PG, you can respect that. So then, so we have ADRD hopping off the team. And you guys have made a trade, two players for one. And that seems to wrap up the gist of it.
Yeah.
Okay. For at least on you guys' side.
Was ADRD just released from the contract altogether?
So what's happening is, I'm not 100% sure if I could say like exactly what's going to happen, but when we signed with Dignitas, pretty much Odie said to us that if we wanted to leave and the team was okay with it, then the contract wouldn't be stopping you from leaving, if you know what I mean.
That's like, incredibly good.
You wouldn't have to buy yourself out for a ridiculous amount. Like some organizations may do.
No. That's the same thing we do here. If a player wants, that's why Arthlon and Zuna were able to be released from their contracts. Is at least from my dealing, most NA teams are along the same line. If you want to leave, very few NA teams are going to be like, "Sorry, you're writing this contract out." You know, they're gonna. If you don't want to be here, you can, and you're not like already going to a new team instantly, then you're able to go.
Yeah.
I have a question with Schwimpy and JPL. Did they? Obviously, you said you picked up one and then kind of bought the other. Did they come as a package? Or if that makes sense.
So we knew that we were going to have Shrimpy in the team since the finals of Prague.
Damn. Okay, because I was in a lot of discussions, and it seemed like the case, but nobody effectively told me.
Because
Schwimpy had it was treating Mavi as like, well, we're moving on. I'm moving on anyway. So
He was 100% leaving Na'Vi post BlizzCon, post the roster lock, and with JPL, what ended up happening was, we approached him and said, "Listen, we want you on the team." Blah blah blah, and I think if Na'Vi didn't lose to us in the semifinals, we'd have a lot harder time getting him on the team. But they did come as a package, like, together.
Okay.
In the whole, like, negotiation sort of situation.
Not sure how much you can talk to this in terms of, like, what's private behind-the-scenes stuff, but how did you go about approaching Schwimpy? Was just like you guys just happened to be bantering at Prague and was just like, "Oh, wouldn't it be cool if you were on our team?" And then like it's sort of like, "Wait, are you serious about that? Like, why don't we talk more?" Or
so what happened was Schwimpy and Bakery wanted to play on a team for a pretty long time now. Like, I think we were actually considering like picking up Schwimpy before the road to BlizzCon.
Wow.
Like tournament. However, what happened was Na'Vi had picked up their crap and started playing really well, and they just qualified for Prague, so we couldn't actually get him without screwing over Na'Vi.
Right.
And he didn't want to screw over Na'Vi, so it never ended up happening.
Huh.
Yeah.
So going into an event like BlizzCon and knowing you guys, you're like going to be future teammates, has to be kind of weird.
Yeah, it was pretty. Well, the thing is, like with the whole, like personality clashes, shall I put, we spent more time hanging around with the Na'Vi players that were replacing the players than we did with our team a lot of the time. So it wasn't obvious, but like the hints were there, if you know what I mean.
Hmm. Well, that's
cool. Obviously at BlizzCon, you guys knew, for like, we weren't actually very secret in any way of saying that we really didn't want to play together. Like, Zoya knows 100%.
Oh, yeah. I think we all knew. I think we all knew that there were internal conflicts, but you guys still got second place with internal conflicts, and that is ridiculously impressive. I'm just excited to see what you guys are able to do with the new squad, because
scary.
It's pretty stacked. Roster. Yeah, it's pretty stacked.
I can honestly say three of the five members on this roster are people we were willing to spend a shitload of money to move them to NA. Like, this is a stacked roster. And he brought up personality clashes earlier, like, it's cliche and stuff, but, like, if you look up through the history of Heroes teams, like, what old C9 went through, what we went through, what you guys went through, like, probably Complexity went through it as well, like, with their multiple roster changes, McIntyre, that it's important. And, like, it doesn't matter how good the five players are individually, like, that matters to an extent, but hopefully you guys actually do get along in-game. The fact that you guys get along outside of game is a big plus, but
that's huge.
Hopefully, I think the whole roster swap was actually really difficult, because we're one of the teams where, like, after scrims or whatever, we'd be playing other games together. We'd be like playing like on TeamSpeak, just chilling together. So it was really hard for us to have the roster swap of Zarmany, more than the ADRD roster swap, because he was the main issue.
So Zarmany going to Na'Vi. Mm-hmm. I actually haven't heard their fifth. Has that been announced?
Well, they're going to be subbing with Wubby, as I understand it, for DreamHack at the very least.
So they haven't signed.
That's their coach. Yeah,
they're not playing at DreamHack.
Oh gosh, yeah, that's.
I thought I read on.
No, they're not playing. They're not one of the eight teams.
No, because the.
You're right.
Trialing with people.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can say anything.
We said this last week, even. We actually said that they were backing out of all future events for this year. Okay, well, that sorts that. Obviously, Dignitas, Virtus Pro, G2, My Insanity, which is a new pickup. We'll talk about that in a sec. Rocket, Team Liquid Fnatic, and Cooler Master. Things have shaken up a lot. Looking at Europe, it was top two was you and Na'Vi. Now you guys have kind of merged, and it's just Dignitas. And Na'Vi's not even present, the rest of the team. Who are you guys worried about now? Like, what's on the radar?
So, roster-wise, I think Liquid's probably the strongest.
Yeah.
Dude,
I'm so cool they signed Gurdum Herd. I remember that guy way back in the Alpha, and he's always just kind of been there. That's so cool they picked him up.
And Chris, right?
Chris, yeah. Gurdum Herd and Chris.
And however, in terms of play and in terms of how long this team's been together, Spartanium, which is now My Insanity, they've got a way of playing the game where if you're not paying attention the whole time, they will roll you, because they have a specific way of playing that will catches people off guard.
They kind of came out of nowhere, right? Spartanian.
Yeah. So it was. They did have Gurdenherd on that team, and now it's Wubby, subbing for them.
Yeah.
I think.
That's Blumbeast and Darkmox team.
Darkmox,
right?
Nurok. Oh, okay. Nurok and You Better Know Me are on that team, too.
Yeah. Nurok,
yeah. So that's a big threat going into DreamHack. We've got the new Dignitas. Chris and Gurdum Herd have joined Team Liquid. But what about teams like Virtus Pro? I mean, they've stayed the same since Europe Finals?
They got rid of
Kuni-chan.
Oh, Kuni, that's right. Yeah. That was a while ago. That was right after Prague.
Yeah, and I've seen that they've gone through a few people. I don't know how much they settled on their fifth.
I think they've been playing with some guy called Power of Dreams, who I've never seen before.
Okay.
It's either him or Nathan, who was in the EPL league thing. It's one of those two, but I'm not 100% sure who's going to DreamHack.
I can't remember if BKB said one of the restrictions that they have is the fact that they're not an English speaking team on comms, and that makes their pool of players that they can reach out to a lot more limited, and that's a growing pain for the team.
Isn't that why a lot of teams go through major roster changes? Is because they do want to swap. A lot of teams want to swap comms, like only like a certain language, like English or something.
Right. Some teams just want to speak Spanish.
Didn't
right.
Liquid do that.
Yeah.
Didn't Liquid go through roster.
They have
Chargers
like two Germans
before.
And now yeah. and some other.
Yeah. So it's definitely it's definitely a problem when looking for tryouts because. I couldn't imagine like having to like sift through people like, oh, by the way, do you speak English? Oh, shit. I don't know.
Yeah.
You think about trying to recruit a Korean player that might not have good English as an American team. That would be...
That's something Stellar Lotus is going
exactly.
through.
And that's got to be trying.
Yeah. It's not like League of Legends where you can just sign, you know, the best mechanical ADC from Korea and then have him just, you know,
ping
do his thing while not understanding anyone. Heroes requires a lot of communication, way more than like almost any game out there. So
fortunately, Koreans tend to have pretty good English in our generation, though, from my experience of just like MLG events back in the day.
I mean, they can speak it, but it's just like conversation English. Like there's a difference between being able to speak it and then handle
so
it.
So I have a question. If you're talking about having conversational English just barely, but not enough to become maybe good friends, right? Maybe not enough to become really social with each other. That's going in some regard that might make it so that it's just a more professional relationship, right? Because you guys are colleagues in that sense and you're not really going to get along as much because you don't speak the same language primarily. Do you think that's beneficial or more of a detriment than a benefit?
I think if you're a top team, it's a detriment for sure. A lot of these teams soon, hopefully throughout 2016, are going to end up in team houses. And if like you're not able to bond and relate with your teammates, you're just going to end up isolating yourself and getting depressed over time. I think you have to be able to be friends with your teammates if you're going to be like living and traveling with them and stuff, or just going to like, unless you're really good at just like, because a player that's kind of like that is Fan. Fan is very like, he keeps to himself at these events. He's not like, he'll go out, he'll socialize and stuff, but like he prefers to kind of just do his own thing. And they make it work so far. So
they won BlizzCon.
You have to just be very, you have to be very careful with it because... I don't know, people like to hang out with their teammates, communicate. And when you're at LANs, like, we're at BlizzCon for 2 weeks. You couldn't, if you didn't have anyone to hang out with there for that long, like, no one to go see a movie with, no one to go to, like, Disneyland with, you're just, like, sitting there in your room, like, well, practice is over and I got 10 hours to kill. What do you do? You know, I think it's important that you do.
Play Hearthstone, man. Easy. All right.
New expansion.
They didn't have a new wing this week. Awful.
It's an adventure, not an expansion.
So, looking at DreamHack, expectations with the new patch, like you think some teams might be stronger than other Athero?
So with the new patch, there's some picks that are completely ridiculous right now in terms of like what they'll do in a fight. So ETC right now is probably undoubtedly the best tank in the game. And I feel like teams that have strong mechanical tanks are going to be like a lot better than teams where the tank will just like die for no reason or get caught.
Is Tyrande a thing in Europe yet?
Of course. Okay. I mean, we have Shrimpy, right?
That's true.
Shrimpy doesn't take sprint, though.
He does. He started.
He does
it.
Now. He does. We convinced him. Yeah, he told us all to our face. Kaywood and Pro and I were standing there talking to him. He's like, "You're dumb for taking sprint. It's so bad." We got him to change his mind.
Nice. Tyrande is definitely a thing in Europe. But the thing with Tyrande, I think the way drafting goes right now is what you are trying to do is on the maps where Tyrande is really strong, is you're trying to deny as much synergy with Tyrande as possible. And that's how drafting in Europe is going right now. So
interesting.
Do you guys first pick her? Or?
Yeah. Okay. It's first or second pick.
Okay.
Or first ban. Yeah. It's very rare that she'll get through to second set of bans, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, right now in NA, it's like a lot of teams just ban her. First pick. Like, just don't even want her in the game at all. So. Yeah.
That's the same with Abathur in Europe.
Yeah, you guys are... NA doesn't do Abba as much. I don't know why. I mean,
he's
still really good.
He's really anti-fun to play against.
Yeah, he is.
Like, once he hits that 7 and he's got the mines, he's just...
Toxic Mist really? Build, man.
It's like 6 seconds of slur, four. I don't.
6 seconds?
Wait, if you're like,
it's at least four.
It's four.
Let's say yeah, you're it's playing, at least four,
yeah. If you're playing like Cursed or something and you're top lane, you might as well not even try and rotate.
Yeah. You'll take like a third of your health that they spec with the damage
to you. It'll take you about like a minute to get top to bot.
The time loss is awful.
Yeah.
I've got a targeted question for Athero as a warrior. What are your thoughts on Artanis? He's a hero that really we haven't seen used anywhere, like, a lot. Do you think he has a place in the game? Do you think he's still weak because of his auto attack? Like, the fact that he can be kited, essentially?
The problem with Artanis is... So, Sonya does his job better in every case. And let's say Sonya's banned. You can, like, there's melee assassins right now that are better than him at doing his job. Like, even unconventional ones. I'm pretty sure Thrall is better than him at doing his job. Hmm. And that's really bad.
Yeah. Like,
and also, like, so the smart way of using his ultimate, like the purifier beam, the smart way of using it is so slow that even if all the person has to be is like tabbed into the game and he can just run away from the ult. Like, there is no way of like getting reliable damage as Artanis pre-16, but post-16 he's really strong, but you have to get
it's just all about the zealot charge and triple strike.
Yeah,
and now because of the games, like early game being so important, that's why I find Artanis to be, I don't know. It's just not enough, right?
You'll probably lose the game because you have Artanis before Artanis is viable.
Yeah, before Artanis wins the game for you.
Yeah. No, I agree with both of them. For the games, like, every time we've drafted them in scrims, it's just been, like, literally, like, let's draft Artanis here. We're like, well, Sonya's up. Well, let's just see how Artanis feels, at least. You know, we've never actually been, like, let's run him because Artanis fits here. I agree with everything they said from the end of the scene. He's just... And also, his kit's not bad, like, he's just, the numbers aren't enough compared to other damages.
I feel like his kit doesn't synergize with itself at all. Yeah. Like, so you have auto WQ, and that's like your whole synergy in terms of kit. Like, his E is completely out of place to the whole of his kit, and it's not very good. Like, it's super slow, it's not that long, like, it's just not a good ability.
Yeah, I was gonna say even if you can hit your E, because like half the time you can't because of how slow and
sure. This is the rise of Nazeba, boys. You zombie wall your Artanis, you swap with someone, boom, you can now land zombie walls. Nazeba's back.
You know how fun it is to play Artanis against a Nazeba and to throw the Nazeba into his own zombies. Oh, that's the most satisfying thing in the world.
I've been thinking about it because like when Artanis first came out, I played him all the way to Master. I did like a 24-hour stream and just played him because I was like, oh, I'm so excited for this hero. And during that time period, playing like 50 games, I quickly realized that if Artanis's charge was switched to, I want to say even 13, and his triple blades was switched to 16, he would be that much more viable because of his like low attack range right now. Mixed with like the fact that his E is incredibly slow and horrible, like, just I don't even know why they would release that talent into the game. If that's like the only way that hero would be worth anything in a competitive game, and like I love that hero, but he's just, I would just play Sonya or Thrall or anything, like put me on Gazlo. Like, I don't want to play Artanis. Like,
I think a buff to the attack range, just his basic attack range, would do a lot too. Like, I'm not sure how much they need to tweak,
like,
that
give
number.
Give him like one or two more.
Yeah,
like, just like
that would be a lot, but something to like even him out compared to some of the other melee assassins.
Make it so his Xyblades shoot out when he punches you.
Because think about Sonya's attack range, right? Compared to what's his face is, I don't know. Yeah, he just doesn't make the cut. Just doesn't make the cut.
So on that same sort of topic, because you guys have been just playing a lot of scrims, grinding it out with this new patch, sort of talking about early game heroes. Artanis, for that reason, is not very good. We talked a little bit about Tyrande. What other heroes are really now starting to see a bit more play? Tyrande, how about Kerrigan? Kerrigan's always one that's sort of jumping out. I know we're seeing a lot of Jaina still, Any other heroes that are sort of popping up a little bit more now in scrims, even or competitive, that's just like, this hero previously was kind of almost in that gimmicky slot because it was just so strong early, but now is actually very viable because of how important the early game is.
I don't know about who's risen, but Uther's fallen off quite a bit.
Yeah,
he's not really seeing his early presence.
Because of ETC, Tyrael is no longer like first pick, first ban. Mm-hmm. Because
that was
to get into a position, to get into a position for a good sank, you need to be in power slide mosh range. So you need to be CC'd to get your anti CC off.
So here, actually, no, I'll hold on to the question.
Okay.
But in terms, I think Kerrigan's gone away a bit because of how good ETC is into it. But like, I think a lot of the picks that have like come in or gone away is due to the ETC. Like, what's good and what's bad into ETC is what is good in the game, because he'll be picked 100% of games.
So the interesting thing about ETC, and this is something that is really, again, very specifically towards you, since I know you play this hero. One of the heroes, one of the warriors that does well against mosh pit setups is Chen with Wandering Keg. And the moment you see the mosh pit being set up, you just pop Wandering Keg, it comes out faster, and you deny the setup. Do you think this gives Chen viability strictly because of ETC being popular?
Because
Chen hits harder. I mean, the way the damage shifts works, he's a bruiser and a good one right now.
I've got like 2 points, right?
Okay.
So one, Keg isn't good because of the Q bug. If the Q bug didn't exist, the Keg would be a lot more viable because you'd be able to Q through them and Keg them back and make a play with the Keg. But because it's not consistent, you can't do that. However, due to the way that scaling's changed, Chen now beats Zagara at level 1. Chen beats every matchup bar Sonya. And even if he loses to Sonya, Sonya can't make that much, like, too much of a difference in the lane. So Chen is super viable for the simple fact is the very worst that he comes out of lane is, like, you've drained the enemy's ammo as Chen. That's the very least that Chen can do in a lane. Hmm. I mean, the most that Chen can do in a lane is take 4. Because there's nothing a lot of heroes can do into him. Like, I feel like the only heroes that can actually deal with Chen is Zagara will, like, stop him from wrecking her until 7. And then, like, that lane's over. like, Leoric can do okay into him. Like, he'll hold him. And Sonya can do okay into him. But every other lane he wins in the game. Mm. So it's really impactful in certain maps. But like, Chen is definitely more viable now, but I don't think with Keg. Because with ETC, what you're running is like a Divine Shield or Sanctification, and you're comboing it. So even if you had the Keg, it would be like irrelevant.
Yeah. Interesting. Well, with the scaling changes, we've started to see some power in auto attack heroes. And Mac, as a melee assassin primarily, how do heroes like Thrall feel in this patch?
They're good. The kind of what Athro was talking about earlier was like CC and ETC are so powerful that like melee assassins are kind of getting punished by that. So like bringing up Thrall, if ETC isn't in the game, it is not bad. But because of the way you have to position in a team fight, he's a target that gets power slid, right? And he has, you know, he doesn't have relentless like Sonya does with Wrath. So once you get slid, then if they follow up and you don't have like, let's say, D shield, then you get smacked down. However, if you're the team that has ETC and you're playing Thrall or even like, let's say, Kerrigan, because we saw, I can't remember, someone at BlizzCon played it. I want to say YL with the Tyrande, like ETC Tyrande Kerrigan.
Yeah, that sounds like something YL would run.
Yeah. It's kind of like ETC is an enabler, just like Uther used to be an enabler, if that makes sense, to melee assassins in the early game. So he power slides, and then Thrall damage is nuts. Like a Wind Fury hits for, I want to say, 3/4 of like a carry's health. early game. Like level one, if you
He shreds Zeratul level one. It's disgusting how fast Zeratul dies.
Yeah. So like if you go up level one and you win Fury a Jaina, you'll deal probably 2/3 of their health, like realistically. And if you hit your wolf and you chain lightning, that's probably 3/4. So if an ETC power slides and you go and do your combo, you'll kill them. However, you know, if you go in and get power slid, then you're out of luck. I remember I played a game and we were against Rainer and I was playing Thrall and he went shotgun build, right? With double shotgun and decreased cooldown at 4. So I got queued 3 times by him and like I was just like, I don't want to play this here anymore. Like I was just like, give me something, anything else. Like, but then other times I've played Thrall and I'm just like, this here is like, it feels like a god, like green Jesus, you know? It's interesting how the new patch has enabled some carries and disabled carries. Like, in my opinion, Illidan is kind of out because he gets single targeted down pretty well. So I don't know. It's very interesting.
Who else got enabled?
Who else got enabled? Well, this isn't a melee assassin per se.
Yeah, but just across the board.
It's an assassin. I this is just my own thoughts. I think Nova's good. I'll just say it out loud. She's like a better Zeratul now, which is even worse for me to say. Because Zeratul used to be a king, but like Zeratul used to have like focused attack follow through, and now Nova is essentially old Zeratul. She has one in the chamber, which is follow through, and then you know, all of her abilities synergize off of that. So you combo the same way. And she can just kill carries. She'll just one-shot carries. So I think she might be sleeper right now.
You think she's got to run Gathering Power?
No.
In Venom?
No, you don't. Yeah, you can go in Venom and still get away with it. If you're feeling gutsy, you can go Gathering.
Okay.
But like Gathering is like definitely win more, if that makes sense. So if you're already winning, I guess you win more sense. Now. Whereas in Venom will just help
you. Yeah, but it's at level 4 you take that talent. Like, already winning level 4 is not really...
You got to be confident.
Yeah. You really have to be like, all right. I mean, you can take it against, like, a Viking, right? Like, it might be a counter for a Viking.
Yeah.
You can take Gathering and then get the full stacks. But I don't know. Maybe I'm being too bold by saying that. But I've been, like, playing Hero League these past few days, and she's just running circles around people. And I've been running circles around people with her. And like she feels like old Zeratul to me, where you can just, if you position correctly, you can just one shot tanks even. Like I don't know, it's insane. I think she's really good right now.
How do you feel about unleashing a wave of Novas upon all of the ladder right now?
That's what you just did.
He did say he got this information from playing in Hero League. Yeah. So take that with, you know, but what it is.
I'll like throw a winky face out there. Maybe not all just Hero League, but
okay. That backs your statement a little bit more then.
Okay, so yeah, but unleashing Novas, I guess you're saying double clone with rewind.
No, there's like every person in chat that just heard you say Nova's good, they're queuing up right now. So that's what he meant about.
Yeah, 5 Novas. No, here you go. You know, 5. There's my unleash where you make 5 Novas and they're all running. It's chaos. It's chaos. Like if you've ever been on the other side of it, it's horrible. Mm-hmm. It's like who's the right, who's the real Nova here? I don't know. Yeah, that's I'm brave by
saying.
It's
been some time. It has been some time since we've seen the Nova.
All I know is what was that? I think the last time too I was on, I brought up Sonya, and now here's Sonya. So. Sometimes you gotta.
So he's got the legendary predictions. Jake, step aside.
I'm done.
Max,
no. Jake's 100% for his predictions too. You just gotta wait till Bloodlust's actually good, and we'll see it again.
Yep, you're right. Guys, remember Warcraft 4 will be out soon. I know all.
Guys, 4 patches from now, and 3 reworks of the game's design, Lili will be viable. Trust me.
I hope that's an accurate stat. Like, that'd be so impressive if that was exactly right. All right, so overall, Afero, how do you feel about the scaling? Like, just as the game is very different, the pacing is a little bit different, the balance for early game, prioritization, dying early means more, like...
Yeah. So, heroes like Falstad have got a lot better because of how they can split, so even if they die, they fly back, right? But, like, so Mayans has just gone out, right? I don't know if it's getting played in competitive at all, but it would be a really good change for Mayans, for the simple fact being is when you're playing Mayans and you die, like, if you get wiped as Mayans, you won't be able to get, like, contest that first golem, which is actually Mayans? Really huge, of course, yeah.
Well, but, I
but, you know, like, in some cases on, like, Cursed or whatever, there'll be the situation where one guy on your team will die, you'll still be able to stall it till he comes back. What will happen now is you have to give up that now that one of your guys have died, because the death timers are way too long. However, something a lot bigger, I think, is towers. Like, you won't need a Sylvanas to push that anymore. Like, you can just tank that and kill a wall for no reason. Like,
good or bad?
I mean, it depends. Like, it depends who's getting killed. I think it's very good for the team that's like, yeah, we can kill this wall right here, get a lead out of it. But you'll be seeing a lot more, like, pushing early game. Like, to get an advantage before, let's say, like, first tribute or first temple or whatever.
Like a tri-lane style.
Yeah, yeah. You'll see some more tri-lanes, but it also doesn't take out the viability of the whole, like, roaming gank squad. Like, if anything, it enables it a little bit more. So I think it's a lot more of a enjoyable game to watch because of how you have to do something early game now. You can't just sit there like AFK in lane and wait till the objective comes up. You actually have to like be proactive in doing things. I think it's a better patch, but like death timers, you can definitely feel it early game.
Mac?
Yeah, I mean, I think one thing he talked about was pushing towers, and I think that those towers and those early game deaths lead to like insane level advantages early. So, I mean, if you look back to previous teams that I've played on, we always tended to play aggressive comps, like Kerrigan, right, obviously. So in this patch, if, say, I play Kerrigan and we kill top and they don't rotate to soak, not only do they get behind a whole wave of XP, we also get towers. Now we're a level ahead. And then if we continue to do that, you know, we get 2 levels ahead, 3 levels ahead. And then that's where you find these like 17 to 14 games that end at 13 minutes. Because you'll just get so far ahead that the other team just can't come back. I've seen that more in this patch than I did last patch, where I think last patch was more like, yeah, let's just hang out. And I mean, Theros had said like proactive, right? Like last patch was like, let's just hang out and wait until something happens. Now it's more, way more about making things happen.
Right.
Because if you do, you're rewarded level advantages. Like, yeah, just like, so here, take a level.
Perhaps before it was, you see that they're going for something that's Rome style. They got like a Murd and Jaina, Toronto, something like that. And she's like, okay, just play super passive. And even though one of the teams is playing something that's very aggressive and what you might call exciting, it's just too easy to counter with just sitting back. So now perhaps we will see, you know, paired up with the impactfulness of those early game kills and needing to get something done early game, maybe we will see something that's really like actually just like really fun to watch in those first 7 levels of the game. So yeah. I hope that ends up coming to fruition.
Zoya?
I mean, I talked about it all out last week. You know, I think I've said my spiel on it. I agree with Mac and Athera both on their points.
All right.
I said all I needed to last week.
One hero we didn't talk about, and a hero that has really risen in the ranks, at least just for Hero League, is Rainer. Rainer was kind of getting a little bit more popular in general, but as an early game hero, he just seems to do absurd damage. Where do you guys think he fits in terms of like the tier list?
It depends on composition. I'm not sure if you guys have already talked about it for this patch. But his early game definitely feels a lot stronger. Last patch, he was autoing for like 40, 50 damage. And now I think it's like 130, 140. And if you let him sit there and attack you as I don't know, a lane would be like maybe Zag's a bad example, but like Sylvanas versus Rainer, okay, and just a 1v1. If Sylv comes up to dagger you and you just start autoing her and then Q her away, like, you'll pull ahead in the trade. Well, last patch, you wouldn't pull ahead in the trade. You would lose the trade. So I guess that's some strength in that. He also isn't too bad, in my opinion, with the ETC comp once you hit 16. So he's not... he can be played in certain comps. I guess I brought that up when I first started talking about this. So if, like, the other team has Leoric, which we're probably not going to see much, but if they do, he's good against Leoric, right? I think he's even good against ETC because of his Q. It's another way to break Mosh, and he can position safely from ETC that he doesn't get power slid. I think he might start showing up in competitive. I'm not sure where Athera feels about it, but in my opinion, I know my team currently has played him in tournaments. So
he's seeing a lot of play in China, at the very least, something probably over a 75% win rate over like the last two weeks. Just looking really quickly through the results, I noticed, even just watching through Cloud9 games, like, oh yeah, the opposing teams were running a lot of Rainer, and he's doing very well over there.
Yeah, I mean, like, one of his weaknesses pre-patch also was his ability to, like, lane, like wave clear and stuff. Like, he's not the best. Like, you have your Q, but even then, like, it's still, like, he's not the best pusher. And with this patch, with it being easier to clear away, he's easier to push in general. You know, that's another benefit, because you don't have, just have, like, this useless Rainer who's going to get, like, bodied in lane. You can just pull ahead and actually do structural damage now with him and stuff. So that just, you know, overall really good changes.
Another thing, too, is, and maybe this isn't too significant, but you don't have to take Seasoned anymore. You can, but you don't have to. So you can go the Give Me More, which it makes your trading even better, right? So if we go back to the Sylvanas in a vacuum, if you're just autoing her, you're going to win that.
Yeah.
You can even get caught, like, and you're still going to come out alive. So I think that changed a lot for him, especially in the early game, so... He's obviously a really strong late game hero. His early game was just his weakest part. Now they kind of fixed it a little bit.
Yep.
So
I don't know if he'll get to the point where he's like high tier, but I definitely think there are plenty of situations to pick him in. I love, like, watching Rainer versus Kerrigan, queuing her mid combo, like, or mid leap is just the most hilarious thing on the planet.
You can do it versus ETC too if you power slide Zeke. The time is a bit different, but you can do it that way too.
I think with Raynor, the only issue I have with him right now is the tanks that he was good into aren't getting picked. Like, you'd pick him into like an Arthas or a Leoric and counter like what they do. But right now what's getting picked is like the Muradins, all the tanks that take imposing. And once you get onto the Raynor, like, sure, he can cue the power slide or whatever, but once you're onto him, like, you're onto him. Like, he ain't getting out of there if you get onto them. And there's a lot of attack speed slow. There's a lot of heroes that will, late game, just one-shot him. Like, I think Kael'thas is completely absurd right now. Like, how much damage Kael'thas does. I think Jaina will just, like, one-shot him. Valor doesn't need to get close to him in the late game. Like, I just feel like other carries, in the situation where we're like, we could pick Raynor here, other carries just seem better, like, in every situation.
Interesting.
I feel like he isn't, like, that good enough yet, you know what I mean?
I think my only thing is because of the new patch, I feel like heroes like Vala have fallen out. Maybe that's just me, but, like, the kind of hybrid carries, other than Falstad and Gust, obviously is really powerful. But Rainer is like a hard carry. Like, you don't see Sergeant Hammer anymore. Like, you don't see Vala.
Have you tried the auto attack, like full Manticore, or just full AA Vala at all?
I have not, no. Is it?
It feels better than in the past.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It feels really strong to me.
Maybe the early game would have spiked that, actually. But even in that case, like, I would just rather have Rainer or
Fall. At that point, yeah. Auto ball is not good.
If I'm good,
well,
yeah, if
the
I'm
difference is like Rainer has the heal, but she has the tumble. So you talked about
he's
how
got
you're
the extra range too, though.
Yeah, it's true. So it's give and take. It's all based on your battleground, and she's just got a slightly different kit. She has maybe easier lane clear. even just with multi-shot, and you're talking, you know, Strafe versus Rainer's Raiders or Battlecruiser. So, you know, it's there's still definitely some big differences.
Yeah. It's just weird when you think about carries now, and that's where, like, Rainer, for me, comes in a weird place, because he's definitely the definition of a hard carry in the meta, right? KT, obviously insanely powerful, probably the strongest carry. The early game scaling buffed him even more. Like, now if you DW twice somebody level one, like, it deals 50% of
the health.
Dude,
I played a game, and this was just quick match, but I got the 30% damage with gathering power. I had 15 kills. And it was the most laughable thing in the world. When I was hitting chain bombs, it was just killing their whole team. Like, it was so... And I picked Pyroblast. Just one shot any hero on the roster, pretty much. Like, so, so absurd. So, that's scary.
I think the reason why Raynor may not be getting played in Europe as much is because you're picking a carry now, not so much of, like, his damage output, because they all do like absurd amount of damage compared to how tanky you are, but how useful they are, like, in your team. Like, for example, Zagara's got the more, Valor even has the slow at 13 if you take multi shot, Kale's got the stun, like, Jaina's got the slow. Like, you're not looking at a carry just for their damage now, you're looking at it for how useful it is in your comp, as well as how much damage they do.
Yeah.
And also, I don't think Raynor has, because what you see now is, because Uther's fallen off a little bit, you might be seeing more medic. And Raynor into medic, Raynor can't actually out-damage medic.
Yeah.
Because medic's healing is quite absurd right now.
Yeah. I think really might be, that's something that's not happening in NA, at least in the games that
I'm playing. No medic yet.
I don't, I've never seen medic. Yeah,
she seems really good in this.
What about in EU? What about Zagara? Zagara's gotten a lot of favor over here.
Yeah,
usually Zagara, tier picked before mid tier bans, like every game.
Yeah,
Not that high priority, but you definitely see a lot more Zagara now than you did last patch.
Yeah, we see a lot of it.
Like, it's because you want to, like, with Zagara, in a lot of cases, bar Chen, but teams won't pick Chen for some reason because they're not, like, comfortable with showing off a niche pick, but Zagara will almost certainly give you a winning lane, like, regardless of how bad or good the Zagara is. Like, he could be like the worst player.
She just trades way too well.
You can just put your Hydra on there and they have to run away. Like, it's pretty annoying to play against.
Zagara's really good.
Any other final thoughts on the first week of the new patch before we talk about Cho'Gall briefly? All right, well, let's just talk about Cho'Gall. Obviously, the new weird hero, two to control a single hero, Cho and Gall. The word on the forums is Gall feels good, but Cho doesn't feel like a warrior. How do you guys feel?
I think if it's probably through the lack of CC. If I had to guess of anything, at least, in, you know, he's got level 10, obviously, but I'm just thinking that if he's going to have to be played in any kind of competitive, it will be like you need a lot of CC to make him effective in any way, whether that's through your carries. I think the one competitive game we've seen him, I think it was a Kael'thas and Uther that he had to be paired with, if you don't run him with another warrior.
Those two Arcanids to the storm?
Yeah. So maybe, I'm not sure, because, you know, I feel like if you put anything on his base kit, it's too strong. Maybe some kind of talent. I'm not sure what it is, but I think that he really needs to be paired against that or up with some more CC. And I think that's probably what it is that people are looking at, where it's like, maybe even just like a way to slow a little bit more consistently, something to that effect, to make his auto attack style a little bit more useful. But right now you're sort of leaning on your team a lot, which is fine, but that's probably where that perception's coming from.
Do you guys think, this is just my kind of idea of Cho, is obviously Cho'Gall is a, well, Cho'Gall together is a, in my opinion, a caster, just a hard to kill caster. I think the idea of the character in most people's perception of him is they're a warrior. Okay, so that's why Cho's getting this flack. Like, Cho's just not a warrior. Cho's, you know, Cho'Gall's not a warrior. I don't think that Cho'Gall is a warrior. So when Tuar drafted a comp that had Cho'Gall as the warrior, to me that felt wrong. So Kubi says something about, you know, CC. Well, most carries, if we put Sergeant Hammer, for example, Sergeant Hammer usually needs a frontline. Cho'Gall needs a frontline. However, Cho'Gall has the ability to be its own frontline. So it's like, to me, I think the hero right now is misunderstood. I think it has potential.
Really?
Yeah, I just think that people need to play it a little more. The synergy between the two players does need to be good. I would say if they sped up the E, I think it would help the hero a little bit. The E is kind of hard to throw and hit. You can sidestep it pretty easily, but I don't know. I think the hero has potential. It just depends on the players and how people play it. Like I said, it reminds me of like Sergeant Hammer. Just protect the Hammer comp, but protect the Cho'Gall comp. And in this case, Cho'Gall is very hard to kill, unlike Hammer, who's a little bit easier to kill. So that's my input on it.
Maybe you're right about people playing it wrong and having to do it right, but yeah, that might be what it takes, because the games I've seen right now, like Cho'Gall's, should not ever be picked competitively. It's so easy to play around. Like, you can just split push, you can just team fight. Like, every we have not run Cho'Gall on scrims, but plenty of teams have tried it, and every single time it's been like 3-4 level leads every time, because we can exploit Cho'Gall. So someone needs to bust, at least from, maybe, you know, maybe it's not the best teams are playing them, or, but I don't know, someone needs to bust out something really
different. Are you is it Cho'Gall defending your pushes, or are you just pushing off lanes?
We only did that once, and he did not defend the push. We only did we did Zavanna, Zagara, like split push one versus Cho, and like we just like out rotated him. Most of the time we like have like a Taranda blow up comp and just like kill the like, if you have Taranda versus Cho'Gall, Cho'Gall will die every time.
Scary.
I think Cho'Gall, like the main problem I see with him is the only map I see him being viable on is Cursed, because that's the only map where the objective is literally sit there and poke at each other until
Battlefield.
One of the teams.
Yeah, Battlefield.
But I feel like against Cho'Gall, all you do is you run 1-2 stuns, like hop on top of him, and the thing again, like the problem is it's too worth it to kill him. Like, if once you kill that Cho'Gall, like normally, if you have a carry, you have two carries, so you have the other one to maybe like outplay or whatever, do enough damage. But what you have is you're taking out one tank, and you're taking out two heroes, like just by killing one hero right there. And the problem is if you take out two heroes and you're on a 3-lane map, you can't rotate. Like, you can't rotate someone into that lane, because you have, let's say you're running Cho'Gall top and you're going like Cho'Gall 1-2. If Cho'Gall dies top, like, you lose too much. Like, you lose too much for Cho'Gall dying. You get two kills worth of XP and like they miss that whole wave, because all you have to do is zone the team coming to soak the wave.
Yeah. I guess I can see him getting exploited. I guess in the games that we've played, the Cho'Gall lane has just crushed. Like, within
crushes lane like really hard.
Like, within the first minute, we have the whole wall dead. It's just like, well, you know, and then now their team has to rotate to defend us, because if they don't, then the fort's gonna die within, you know, another minute and a half. And it's like, I don't know. I could see it. I could see that being a weakness. I guess
it's just
I just
different
haven't
from
felt it.
Our perspective, just because we never run the Cho'Gall, like we have yet to draft it. Like, we're always playing against it, and so far it's been pretty easy to play against.
I'm just glad to hear that there's actually some viability, even if only some maps. I mean, that's such a weird hero design. That's really cool.
Yeah, he will get picked. He will definitely get picked. It just depends on how viable is he. Just like a niche type, like, oh, look at C9 busting Rexxar out on Dragonshire, or will he be like, I mean, you know what? He actually fits here.
Look at Lost Vikings. How often do we see them off Garden? Like, we really don't a whole lot anymore. So, having weird niche picks.
You see them on shrines quite a lot.
That's true, because the dragon. But still, you know, that's because of summons, because of, like, being able to throw one Viking in a summon, there's, like, an added value to that hero.
I meant Infernal Shrine.
Oh, okay.
Because of the objective.
Oh, like... I heard Shire in my head. I was like, I don't remember the last time I summoned Dragon Shire, but okay.
What do you think about the idea that you can release a hero just to be that hero and then not ever balance him competitively? Because everyone's always talking like, well, Cho needs this, Gaul needs this, together they need this. Is it so bad if Blizzard just leaves him as he is?
No,
like, of
that's
course,
a good
be
thing.
Fine tweaked for like if Hero League stats are off or something, like you change numbers and all. But as a kit and as a playstyle, he is designed to be this. Because right now, what he is like a one character being controlled by two, he is perfect. Like, he is fun to play with your friend, like everything, like it's exactly what you would want.
Yeah.
Would you be okay if Blizzard just like, we're never going to balance Cho competitively. We just want him to be what he is.
You said the important thing. Is it fun?
Yep.
Like, it's always going to have to, there has to be some redeeming factor to play. And as long as the hero's fun, I think that can work.
You're and never.
If Blizzard tomorrow was just like, yeah, we will never balance him competitively.
That's fine.
I'd be okay with that.
You'd be okay?
As long as they're not making.
I'm okay with that too.
As long as they're not making it a consistent thing. Because, you know, as a competitive, like, just viewer, caster, you know, whatever, like, you want to see more additions to the pool of viable heroes.
But like, with a weird
every
thing
once
like
in a while
that,
they're gonna throw something in. Like, Cho'Gall has done wonders
for
the perception that this game has received since BlizzCon.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of new people are coming in and playing it. It's getting a lot of hype, a lot of talk, even just outside the game, what a crazy hero this is. So just like, if they're gonna throw stuff like that in every once in a while to really bolster the game's popularity, go for it. Even if it's not competitive, go for it.
Yeah.
All right.
I feel like Cho'Gall doesn't need a lot though to become competitively viable.
Yeah, I mean, that's great. Saying, like, if he were to be like, just say he was ass, like just one of the worst heroes, but he filled what Blizzard wanted from a design perspective. He's like,
Jared,
fun.
I like the way you say ass.
Like Lili tier, right? Lili works in Hero League and stuff, but she doesn't seem play and competitive. If Blizzard were to be like, we're going to leave Lili how she is kit-wise because she works for the masses, she's fun to play for those people that like that style. Competitively, she just won't work out ever unless we change stuff, and we don't want to do that. Like, is that an okay mentality for Blizzard to take on, is what I'm saying.
But I feel like all he needs is not anything to do with stats or anything in Cho. I feel like the only change they need to make to Cho is once he's winding up his Q, he gets CC'd, it goes on full duration.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I feel like that one change would make him at least quite a lot more viable. Because if you get CC'd, you're dead. Like you have to take the 7 talent that insta winds, and if you get stunned, well, you're dead. I feel like that one change of like not putting it on a full cooldown if he gets CC'd would actually make him really viable.
Yeah,
I could see that.
All right. We've talked about Cho'Gall. We've talked about scaling. Let's talk about Towers of Doom. Just went live a few hours ago. I don't know how much you guys have been able to play. Probably just a few games.
Yeah, I got a game on it.
But just giving everyone the rundown, it's a new battleground that kind of breaks the rules. I know that was like my trigger word for a few episodes ago, but I'm saying it again. In the sense that you can't even go into your opponent's base. You try to approach the base, you die. The way the objective works is basically you channel altars. It's just like Cursed Hollow, where you channel tributes. And if you channel an altar, it does damage to the enemy team's core. Mule doesn't work on the cores, but Mule is beneficial in the sense that there are 3 keeps on each team. Keeps, when destroyed, give you more power from the objective. In theory, if you control all 3 of the enemy team's keeps, you can have up to 7 damage when you channel a single altar. And
you do 1 damage if you control all the keeps. That's something that I learned today.
Yeah. Oh,
you control
You do 7 damage if you control all of them. Each keep is worth a damage.
Well, no. Like, if you control every keep, your core just starts throwing a fireball at
Wait, what?
Core.
Yeah.
Yeah, like every, like, 5 seconds.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, so I learned that today when we were playing, like...
That's cool.
Yeah, that's something that's new that I didn't know about. So pushing is important. You can give up shrines if you control forts.
And there's other interesting things. So, like, if you have control of this bottom... fort down here, and you grab these pumpkin dudes, the pumpkin mercenary camp, normally they would walk down this bottom lane and attack it. But if you control it, they will opt to go up to the top lane. But in the event that you control both of these, the pumpkin dudes will go up to this mid lane, and then they will run, and as soon as they get to this line, they just damage the enemy team's core. So, like, there's just, like, a lot of really interesting things. The merc camps will work completely differently in this map. The Headless Horseman is...
Were those all things that were on the PTR? Like, the core damage from from controlling all six?
Yes.
I didn't test it enough to know for sure.
But I never once had all six. So.
It is not really that common of a situation, yeah. That was a thing that was existing.
Right on.
So
I mean, I don't ever see that happening in a competitive match, but
no. Yeah. Considering how different the map is, though, like, what are your thoughts on it? Like, do you like it? Does it scare you?
I think it's going to be potentially another Mines, but the simple fact being is, so, like, let's say you get ahead, like really far ahead, and you get wiped. What do the enemies get? They get one of your keeps, maybe two of them. Yet you're still doing damage to their core if you get like the tribute or the whatever it is, the shrine. So I feel like there's not going to be a lot of those like huge plays where like late game where you ace them, you take the boss, and you try and make a push for the core. So there isn't going to be these huge comebacks, which I think kind of sucks. But I feel like strategies on this map are going to be reliant around like the double easy camp in the middle. Like there's going to be a lot of strategy based around those easy camps. But the simple fact being is they do way too much damage to the keeps.
Yeah.
Like if you take double easy camps and then let's say you go like top lane to push the keep top, they either lose bot keep or they lose top keep. Like it's really, really strong how powerful these like little guys are. I don't know what they are.
Pumpkin bros, they call them.
Screen them on the PTR with this map?
No. I just thought
this is just
that
from your play?
But okay. I feel like there's not going to be a lot of comebacking in this map.
Yep.
Yeah. It's funny,
that's
like
what we talked about last week.
Yeah, I was playing in Hero League and we had like they had done like I guess 30. We had 36 damage total left on ours, so they had turned in once, and the enemy had four, and it was just like, how many times do we have to die for them to deal 34 damage to our base, right? Like, you know, like how do you lose from that position in the map? But I think it's interesting too, because what gets me with this map is, do you get forts, or, you know, what's important? Because forts give XP, right? And if you kill the other team's forts and they do a turn-in or a shrine or whatever you want to call it, you know, they might only deal two damage to you, but you're up two forts. And so you're an XP ahead. So, you know, maybe you could force the sixth shrine or the sixth fort, sorry. Like, there's a lot more to the map that I think that most of us aren't seeing because we haven't got to play it enough. I just feel like there's a kind of a deeper level of understanding to the map.
I'm so excited to cast this map.
Yeah. I love doing the boss and being able to be like, you know, we've been losing the whole game and we go in and steal a boss material and then win. Like, oh my God, yes. But like, you might not be able to do that on this map. But there's so many other things that you can do on this map. I think it's interesting. I don't know. It'll be really cool to play. I haven't got to sink my teeth in it.
Do you know if you get XP if you take keep?
Yeah, like, you do get XP. So that's what I'm saying. Like, maybe you just sack the early game, get two forts, and then give up a shrine, right? So now the team deals two damage to your keep or your core or whatever, but you have a level advantage. I don't know. You know, now you can control the easies, like you talked about controlling the easy camps. I think there's just a lot more to the map.
I agree.
Yeah. So.
Well, that's cool. Obviously, with really limited practice, we can't speculate too much, but overall, pretty excited. Few bones I want to pick. Blizzard has officially named the keeps bell towers in this map. This is a bell tower. You can see the bell here, and that's good and fine,
but
right?
They all had different names.
During the loading screen, it says control the bell towers or something.
Because it'll be like blue team takes the farm. One of them's like the vaults. One of them's like the weapon.
Oh, I see. Because this is not a bell tower.
I think they all have different names.
Well, make them look different if they have different names. But and these are apparently goblin sappers.
Okay.
I don't know what kind of goblin that is, but
just wearing a hat, man. Leave him alone.
And a stick arm that's like a bench fork.
Yeah, why are you judging?
I think another. I was gonna say jumping in. I think another thing that I just thought about was this map has the Nidus worm or whatever that's built into it. I forgot all about it, but I don't know how that's gonna play in the late game. Like you'll be able to back and then tele mid. Like you can control the tele mid, right? Like they have the sewers. Yeah. So. If you guys haven't played the map, there's a sewer system in the map, so you can essentially teleport from your base to the middle sewer. I don't know how it'll change or affect the game, but like I said, you can control that, you know, as a team.
Yeah.
So when they spit out, you just kill them. You can back during a team fight, right, and get full, and then climb back in. I don't know. That's an interesting mechanic. They haven't introduced a teleport mechanic
That you could camp it if you're expecting the enemy team to come through it. Could wait for like ambush and stuff. Like I'm so excited for those kind of plays to happen.
Yeah, and there's a shrub right next to it.
Yeah,
that covers right, most of the right on top there's of it. A couple structures nearby, so it's something that you don't have good sight of all the time.
Couldn't you just like have a Kael'thas, leave him there solo, and then if the enemies don't know that your team isn't there, like. You just chain bombs. They have to run away.
Yeah,
like that could be pretty brutal. Yeah, you could show top, and they're like, "Oh yeah, let's all go through," and then chain bomb. Yeah, I don't know. It's an interesting mechanic.
So, until we see actual competitive games on it, I mean, right now this map's so like different out in there. That's either gonna be like a really cool, unique map that people bust out, or it's gonna be like Haunted Mines, where everyone but like 2ARC plays it. Or doesn't play it, rather.
Yeah, Haunted Mines is gone, too, from all ladders. It's just no longer there.
It's still in the game in custom games, though, right?
Yes, you can still play it in custom games. So if tournaments want to run Haunted Mines, it's totally viable. That would be a big issue if they just opted to remove it. I mean, imagine a season, like a mid-season league or something that would have to just pull the map out. That would be awful. I think that's what we should remember to make, like, just how many maps should be on the ladder at one time. I get a discussion for a future show because that's a really good topic as we're getting to have tons of maps now. But let's move on to talk about the Bob Ross fan club. Now this is, everyone put your cap of Ross in chat because that's the closest thing you guys have to a logo now. A new powerhouse team.
Yeah. Pretty exciting stuff.
Tell me about how it all came to be. Tell me everything.
Tempo Storm lost BlizzCon. Two players
in glorious fashion.
Two players were released from the team.
They were not released from the team. They left.
And I got a message on Skype to play some video games. So that's how our team was made. We decided to start practicing. We've been playing really well, honestly. It's weird for me as a player too, because I guess I played with a good team with Complexity. They're all great guys. But with this new team, it just feels so much quicker. As like the melee assassin player, I can go in and I know everybody's gonna follow me up. I don't even have to say anything. So it's very, very different. The gameplay, the game style, I guess I should say. So, like I said, if I'm playing Kerrigan and I hit a combo, I don't even have to say I'm going to combo, really. Everyone will go, which is a good change of pace. And we all get along well. So I'm excited, honestly, for our future. I think we're going to do great things in the scene. I can't wait to play Cloud9. That's a really exciting game. And Tempo Storm, whenever they work out their kinks. Or figure out the machine. I'm very excited. I think we'll do great things.
You guys came out guns blazing as look at this, the entrance storm qualifier number one. And did you guys drop a game? No, you didn't.
I did not.
I mean, we couldn't because it was best of ones. But,
true.
Still, I will say in most of our games too, they were pretty commanding.
They were stompy. Yeah, definitely.
I think we had like two or three 13-minute games. Like,
wow.
Yeah. Like I said, we're definitely an aggressive team. You'll if you watch our games, you'll see that.
To give insight into that, your role is melee assassin.
Yeah.
No one's role is melee assassin. The role is flex.
Yeah.
You guys are so aggressive that you're just a melee assassin because you're going to go aggro every single game.
Yeah. And I mean, honestly, like, we've changed it up, right? But like you said, we're gonna go hard. We're not gonna show you respect. Like, you know, if you slip up, we're gonna come kill you. We're gonna rotate heavy. We're gonna invade heavy. Like, we're definitely a team that's not afraid. Which in NA there were teams like it. Cloud9, obviously, all very individually skilled players. I think Zoya and like a couple shows ago talked about Cloud9 and shot calling. I think that was like with Dread and KO last week or something like that. You guys were saying like Cloud9 has a bunch of shot callers, right? They don't have a shot caller. That's like, that's Bob Ross fan club. Like, we don't have shot caller. I mean, we all talk, but we can all make decisions for ourselves and we can all shot call a game, right? So when you put a bunch of players that can make this, I think I would say Dignitas is a great example of that too. You guys come off as a team that you all seem like you know what you're doing, right? And so when you get put a bunch of confident players like that together, you get good results, obviously, that tournament. We can't wait to play in more tournaments and continue to show our skill and our talent. But like I said, I'm very excited to play with this team. I can't wait to, live this 2016, you know,
the dream.
Heroes of the Storm. Yeah, right? Like, there's so much coming up. And
What are you guys setting your sights on next to try to enter to prove yourselves? So you just jumped into the first qualifier for Enter the Storm.
Yeah.
You guys swept that pretty easily. But there have been a few more qualifiers since then, and it's not like you win one of the qualifiers, you're into the final event. So you guys have made a decision actively, whether you guys are busy scheduling-wise, you couldn't enter the other ones. I'm not sure what the case was. Mm-hmm. But so what are you guys looking at?
I mean, there's not a lot going on in NA at the moment, really.
But why haven't you been playing the other Enter the Storms?
Oh, sorry. Well, last week, Arth had to leave. So Arth had to go home, and I had a family something come up. The previous week, I can't remember what happened. But we're going to be playing this weekend, and we'll play the next week. There's like 8 qualifiers.
There are,
And we're second seed right now, and we played in one tournament.
I think you guys are third now.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so we...
cool, I'm not worried about it.
Anyway,
confidence.
No matter the seed, we're still... There's still
you're behind Kappa Wolves.
Yeah, gotcha.
And, you know, we're still going to play in a tournament, and...
That's not even coming across as, like, we think you guys are being cocky about it. It's just we want to see you play more. Like,
I
want to see how it's going to, you know, develop. Because you guys are such an aggressive team, it's honestly very exciting to watch.
I make the joke on my stream, like Dave Chappelle, where he's like, you know, he's scratching his neck, and it's like, y'all got any of that Kappa Ross gameplay? You know, like, everyone's like, when are you guys playing again?
Yeah, no, I'm anxious to cast you guys.
I got a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
What are your thoughts on the kind of complete upheaval of what was the top teams in NA and how it's just been kind of like tossed aside for now? Like, Murloc Geniuses aren't getting the same results as before. Cognitive isn't getting near the same results as before. Complexity.
Murloc's doing pretty well, actually. Yeah. They've won 2 of the Enter the Storms.
Yeah, but
it's interesting. Damn. Yeah, it's interesting. I think that the change in gameplay, like the patch, obviously has changed some things. Some teams are adapting, others aren't. We were talking about earlier, like teams that sit around and do nothing, if that makes sense, right? Like those teams are having an issue here. Where the teams that, I mean, look at Cloud9, they're in China, right? They're playing against these new teams, but they're losing games. Like,
yeah, this patch is giving them.
Exactly, right?
We'll get there. Like, we'll get there, stream.
Yeah, okay. and King Caffeine and Dunk are, you can see in their play that they're struggling. So that could be a problem, right? Or a change. I don't know. I'm not really sure why the hero scene is. It might have to do with the fact that there's not a lot going on, so people aren't motivated.
That could be it. Because from Meyer's perspective, like, it went from Vegas to we only scrim three teams. Like, after post qualifying for BlizzCon, it was we only ever watched, like, played C9. We would sometimes scrim, like, Cognitive or Complexity or Murlocs, depending on when C9 couldn't scrim us. And then we would be watching the other regions. And then after, like, that whole month and a half of preparing for BlizzCon, come back to, like, let's scrim the top teams in NA. And it's like, actually, Blaze is actually really good now. They're one of the top teams. They got teams like Elevate and stuff that are, like, on the rise. It's like, it feels like a very different scene when it comes to who's, like, the big dogs. Because before it was, you had, like, four or five really good teams that only scrimmed each other. Then you had, like, a bunch of teams that were, like, huge drop-off between 5th and 6th.
I don't know what happened with COG, dude.
Now there's, like, one really good team right now in NA, which is Bob Ross. Like, they're talking about, like, scrims and, like, the local tournaments, because C9 does it. I'm excluding C9 from all this right now. You have Bob Ross Fan Club, who probably seems like the best team currently in the States. And then, you know, we're going through tryouts, so I don't even want to say we're, like, top 2 or 3 right now. We're, like, we're going through. But, like, literally, it's just, like, Bob Ross and then, like, amateur teams, just like a slew, like a bunch of them, where it's like there's still a pretty considerable gap between. It just feels very different coming back to it, because before definitely felt, and I know you've been playing in that time period, so
yeah, it's interesting too, because it's hard for me to say. We don't scrim that much. There's not a lot of teams scrimming. I think, like, we were talking about, like, teams aren't practicing, there's not a lot going on, so maybe teams don't feel motivated to scrim. I'm sure in, like, Europe right now, you guys are probably going crazy over there, right, with DreamHack and stuff, like,
his flight's maybe, like, an hour after the show or something.
Yeah, maybe not, but,
well, the problem is, so with the Dignitas team that went to BlizzCon, the strength that we had was we would be very strong at playing a team a lot and finding out what they can do, right? Whereas what's happening once we've come back from Europe, we've completely changed, or from America, we've completely changed how we do things, and teams aren't scrimming us at all. Like, we have, I think in the past 3 days, we've scrimmed Fnatic and My Insanity a little bit. That's it. No one else will play us.
Oh, wow.
But the simple fact being is they don't want us to practice and win this tournament. Okay. So
we've experienced a lot of that here in NA.
So what's happening? Yeah. So, like, we've had 6 days since the official signing. We've had 6 days to practice for this event. And we've got barely any scrims.
Easy.
Which sucks. Yeah. So, like, if we end up winning, then that says a lot about Europe. I'm just going to say that.
Wow.
Well, if you need scrims, come to NA.
We have no accounts. How can we do that? We have to level that.
You got the 50% off everything right now.
Yeah.
Oh, there we go.
There you go. Just drop your BlizzCon paycheck.
Yeah, we know how much you got from second place at BlizzCon. So. No excuses.
But I guess, like, okay, so, yeah, even though you guys might not be getting scrims because of other teams, I'm sure you're motivated to play, right? Like, just because you have nothing to practice against, right? You still want to play. And I think that's, like, again, the problem here is people just don't want to play anymore. Like, I play Hero League a lot.
You're one of the few.
And it's because I stream and whatever. But when I play Hero League, no, it's dead. And that's what I was talking about in the pre-show. I play on the Europe server, and I play Hero League, and I get all, like, I play against all the pros, I guess, over in Europe, like, every morning. If I queue up 5 stacks, just, like, good teams on both sides, like, and then I play NA Hero League, and I queue up at, I don't know, 8 o'clock, right? And it's just nothing. It's, like, dead games.
There's, like, 4 or 5 pros, like, almost on the top of my head that, like, do Hero League, like, Dreadkale, McIntyre, the Korean from Stellar Lotus, and
Wiz.
Yeah, Wiz. Yeah, that's, like, literally, there's, like, a handful. And then there's, you know, a bunch of amateur players that are trying to play and or like enjoy playing the game. But all these pro teams or these, you know, semi-pro, whatever you want to call it, like, they're not putting in hours. I don't know.
Do you think that when the Hero League has bans, this will help at all?
I don't think it should matter. I mean, it's a principle. Like,
I doubt that.
Yeah.
I doubt it very much.
I mean, I like the no bans, sort of, because then you can just play whatever you want. Like, I if I want to practice Zeratul, at some point I'll get to play Zeratul, right? Like, if you look at League of Legends with solo queue, sometimes in League of Legends, like, Fiora's always banned. I don't know. There's certain heroes that are always banned, and you would never get practice. And in heroes, you can get practice. Like, you have the ability to. So obviously that'll change it up. Maybe Hero League will become more competitive, but I still think players should be playing. If you want to get better, right? If you want to be a top team, you need to play the game. Like, you don't have an excuse. Otherwise, you'll be Cognitive or Murlocs, and you'll slowly start to roll over. You won't be where you were.
Good point.
Right?
The thing that will, like, make people play Hero League is the Grandmaster, whatever the hell it's going to be. For the simple fact being is, in Europe, when the rankings came out, the top 100 rankings, every single game, it would be 5 against 5 pros.
Yeah.
For about a week, and then the EPL thing started up. That lasted for about a week or two, and now pretty much no pros play Hero League as much. Like, you see the odd, like, pro, but you don't see them every game.
Yeah.
But that's probably due to everyone scrimming each other for, like, a large majority of the day.
Like, yeah, it's weird you bring that up, because, like, I take a lot of pride in... I mean, I got number one on the leaderboards. Like, it's maybe not...
Subtlebrags.com/McIntyreHats.
I was ranked for one.
It's maybe not a big deal to some of you, but...
No, it's awesome, dude.
I did get it. Like, you can't take that from me, so... And I worked for that.
You
like,
can.
Played,
you just got to beat them on the ladder, and then you can take it from
next
them.
Next month, I'll probably be 5. Whatever, it's fine. But I did get one. and I played very hard, and I tried very hard, and, you know, I dedicated my time to it, and it paid off. Like, and I think you're totally right. Like, once Grandmaster comes out, people are going to be all over it. Like, you'll get Hero League games all the time because, you know, then my little number one will change to 2, and somebody else becomes 1, and it's just like, you know, look at Hearthstone. Like, there's nothing. You get 10 coins a game, or like every 3 games, like, and people grind hundreds of games a day.
Yeah, but you can also absentmindedly grind Hearthstone while working. It's kind of a hard comparison with Hearthstone.
Oh, I guess, buddy, there's a legend system. People play competitively. Yeah. I think there's a reasonable correlation.
Yeah. Oh, I thought he was talking about just like the casuals.
Come on, buddy.
I thought he was talking about casuals. Like,
I'm talking about, like, once you breach legend,
I see.
You can sit there and dump hours and hours and hours. And, like, right now, once you hit rank 1, like, what's the point, right?
Yeah,
like,
okay. I see your point.
And even me, like, I play Hero League and I hate it, because the matchmaking system right now is just so broken and it's disgusting. I match with rank 41s and stuff, like, it sucks because nobody's playing. So if people played, if that system was introduced, then my games would be better and everyone's games would be better. I don't know. More people would play. So, yeah. I don't know.
Hopefully. I don't play Heroes anymore. Because of a lot of those reasons.
Like, see, like,
last time I played was when I streamed to Jake.
No passion.
No interest to play. I love the game. I'm in scrims every night watching. Watching every tournament that comes out, but I just have no enjoyment of, like, lot. Like, let's do a few Hero League games. Like, what's the point?
I love this patch.
And I'm not even a pro.
I think the game's way more fun in this patch. Matchmaking's still annoying, but I've been having so much more fun with the game. Assassins feel so badass. Like, at the end of the day, assassins feel like playmakers now. And I like that. I think that makes the game just more entertaining to play and watch. We need to keep going through our topics. I feel like I wanted to... Oh, yeah, I had one more point for Bob Ross Fan Club. And obviously, you guys have been on a variety of teams between Cloud9, Complexity, Tempo Storm. There's quite the portfolio from the players in their past experience. Obviously, you got to be looking for a sponsor. I know the team is brand new, But you guys got to have some kind of idea. Have you guys put the feelers out already? Like, what's that plan look like?
I mean, yeah, we're definitely looking right now. Again, it's very hard because, like, most of the time it's like, hey, we're looking for a sponsor. And they're like, all right, we'll show us the results. And there's nothing to show results in.
So just lack of opportunity right now?
Yeah, I think that's what's holding us back. Obviously, I would say that people know that we're there, right? Like you said, big names that have been on teams, that have been on, you know, established players, you know, ranked number one in A, all on the same team, right? Like, anyways, you know, all on the same team. So people know that we're there. They're just waiting for us to, I guess, achieve something.
I'm actually we are
looking.
I'm really interested for 2016, considering Blizzard seems to have big plans for Heroes next year. So organizations like EG, TSM, CLG, like that don't have teams, I feel like it's only a matter of time before they hop on board because, I mean, BlizzCon got 100,000 viewers or so, like in, live in the venue, probably 7,000 people watching. I mean, it did good. So we'll see. Best of luck getting you guys a big sponsor. You guys deserve it.
Right. Just keep in mind, though, it also should be like, you know, when sponsors look at teams, like they're like, we're going to be patient and like watch your results. Like it's also good from your perspective to be patient as well.
And make sure good point.
Because there are a lot of teams that screw over players, screw over, like, you know, we had the Murloc Geniuses back when they're on Zebron. You know, there's a lot of shady organizations that, like, you know, so it's also important just to be patient from your guys' end. Because if you guys know you're going to be good, then you're going to get eventually the God tier offer.
Yeah. We're not going to snap at the first thing that comes to us. Let's put it that way. We'll wait. And this next season, you know, I think opportunities, like you said, Jake, are going to open up, obviously. Yeah. Big tournaments, big viewings, hype. Just a whole lot of exciting stuff ahead of me. So.
All right, I got one more question.
Okay,
sure.
Probably a bit of a hard-hitting one. Let's see what you think about this. you guys do have the criticism, just like immediately going into it, that the people on the team may be perhaps difficult to work with. Mm-hmm. And you have already stated that you guys have, like, you know, an aggressive play style in a game like Heroes where that team synergy has got to be there. It's got to be on point. What would you say to those people who are giving that criticism?
I think the best way that I've kind of come up with an answer for that is like the players on our team. Like, I know a lot of people at the start were like, oh, I can't wait for this team to crash and burn, you know? Like, they're going to lose once, and that's going to be it. I think with the players on our team currently, we all respect each other as players. And in the past, we've had issues with, I don't know, like, maybe we think somebody's not up to par, or somebody's not playing as good as they could be, or, you know, we're stuck with somebody on our team that we're like, we don't want to play with them anymore, but they're on our team. And the cool thing about this team is, in my opinion, it's the first team that's taken a bunch of good players from a bunch of different teams and made a really, really powerful team. Up until this point, everyone's kind of been like, I mean, even with like Barrel Boys and Complexity, like we were a bunch of friends and we were obviously good at the game and we grew right together. We grew as players. Some of us grew bigger than others. And that happens. But in this case, it's like taking the best players from every football team or something and putting them on one team. It's new. It's exciting for everybody. It's exciting for me. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. Right now, it's working great. We're getting along. Like I said, we all respect each other as players. We respect each other's point of views. Like, if Urho says something, I'll be like, yes, I totally see that. And then I'll say something and then he'll come back and be like, yo, I see that too. So there's no issues internally. I don't see any issues happening as long as everybody's playing well.
But what happens when someone's not playing well? Does the ship crash? Does the yelling begin?
I mean, okay.
Because everyone has a bad day.
Everyone bickers, all right? It's esports. I've been on multiple teams. I've been on multiple teams at this point. I can tell you, like, all teams bicker. It's like, you know, in my opinion, it's, do you respect that player? Can you make it past your bickering and continue to play. And I think with this team, we all can do that.
That's what matters.
Are you playing Vanilla WoW yet? That's the only way you truly gain the respect.
I
All right. let's
insta tilt instantly.
All right. Let's move on and talk about Gold League. Now, Gold League takes place in China, if you guys are unfamiliar. And Cloud9 actually flew out there only days after winning the world championship at BlizzCon to compete in Gold League.
They were invited.
They were invited, but they're the one foreigner team. And
no, there's GHQ from Taiwan.
Okay. The one Western team. You know, going over there, they talked big game, and they go out and they play SBT week one or day one, and they make it through 2-1. Go to week two, they play Braveheart. Braveheart was at BlizzCon, and kind of.
Yeah.
And they lose 1-2. And here we go to their third round, or they lose 2-0-0. What are they doing? This seems, is China that good? Is Cloud9 playing poorly? What's the deal?
Cloud9, anytime there's change, has always been a team that gets crippled by it. Their win streak was from a patch to a patch that not much changed meta-wise. From like the end of August qualifier to BlizzCon, the game was fairly the same. Right, it was nothing changed big when it comes to gameplay style and stuff. But anytime anything's introduced to the game that completely shifts how the game should be played, it's always kind of hurt C9. Right, like when promote came out, when flip pushing came out, like every time there's a big shift in how the game is played play style wise, they always kind of have trouble adapting to that. And this patch kind of did that. In my opinion, there's a lot that's been changed. They're always been the best drafters, but they've always had trouble adapting
to the draft.
And so I think it's potentially that maybe just the changes they're not adapting them to them well. Also, they could be like sandbagging for a better seed, like they've done that before in the past. I can never tell when I watch C9, are they faking or are they actually giving it or they're actually just getting bodied, like. They're a weird team, man. I never understand them, but I don't know. Maybe they're just having trouble adapting to the new patch. Last two losses were on the new patch, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Athera, thoughts on their games? Have you seen them?
I saw a bit of the Lili game, the game where Lili was picked.
Okay.
And I think
that just stood out to you. You just had to watch Lili, right?
Well, I mean, the issue I see with Cloud9 is... even in the world championships, they're the sort of team that will sit back and their late game decision making is the thing that will win them games. And the issue is these Chinese teams are getting too far ahead in the early games for them to use their late game decision making. And also what's happening is if they are staying equal, the Chinese are doing these weird like party bush like strategies where they just or hop out of a bush randomly where they shouldn't be, but they are. And they're getting a lot more out of it with these party bush strategies because of the long death timers. And I feel like it's crippling Cloud9 a lot more than what it should. But I feel like give it some time and Cloud9 should probably start winning again.
Yeah. I think I think Cloud9's kind of based themselves around niche picks and like compositions they know and play styles they know, so they figured out a style that works for them, and now they've gone over to China and like you said, those bush strats, right? Like those don't happen. I don't think they've ever really happened. Like coming into your side bush, right? Like all the way you come out of your gate of your base and there's a bush and they're just sitting there waiting for you. It's like, you know, how can you anticipate that? And I don't think they have, and they've just been getting ran all over because of it. Losing early game and like some of the, like I said, their niche picks, like Arthas is completely out of the game right now. like, don't even think about playing Arthas. Like, Leor, Caffeine's, like, hero.
Yeah, he's not rip.
Yeah, not, like, he's not 100% dead, but he's pretty bad he's compared pretty dead. To...
Compared
yeah,
to, like, yeah. Muradin or ETC.
I mean, why you're gonna... You
pick him.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's, like I said, a lot of their, like, don't train Uther, right? You think don't train, you think Uther. Uther, he's done.
That's true.
Like,
yeah, that's a good point.
So it's, like, Zeratul, right? We saw Fan and iDream played Zeratul. They would snap that up every once in a while. Like, that's kind of out. Like, so all these, like I said, these picks that they kind of anchored on are slowly becoming a lot weaker. But I do think they have that understanding of, like, the Tastaronda, and that's really in. So I think they'll also kind of turn a corner at some point. But it might take a little while for them to adjust.
Koobs? Just overall thoughts?
Yeah, I think those points hit it pretty well. So they're sitting 1-2 right now in their group, and I was sort of looking at some of the outcomes for it. I mean, they're still in control in terms of being able to get out of their group if they win their next two games against YL. And is it...
X Team?
Yes, X Team.
But that's the second and third place team right now, so...
Yeah, no, but I'm saying, like, if they step it up, they're still able to get out into the playoffs. There's some weird situations that pop up if they win one and lose the other, where they can get out, but it's a little bit more dependent on the other teams. If they lose both of them, I mean, obviously.
Do you guys...
That's it.
...know what their practice situation is? Do you know if they're able to practice regularly, if they have, like, certain scrim blocks? Like, what's their scenario?
I know they have, like, they have places they go to practice and stuff.
Like, just like LAN centers, or?
I think one of C9's sponsors has an office out there they're playing at.
Wow, that's great.
I know that they have access to practice. I didn't ask. Like,
yeah, I'm just.
I talked to him
recently.
Just curious. Like, how much he's been practicing and stuff. So I don't know to that. I'm curious is like if most of the Chinese teams are willing to scrim them, or they're like, oh, these guys are the foreigners. Let's just blacklist them and get them last place. You know, I have no idea what. Exactly, it's happening there.
Huh.
But I know they have access to practice.
Cool. Well, I mean, if just looking at the picks, we see a lot of Tyrande, a lot of Muradin being played over there. I mean, each region kind of has their own meta, but it's just interesting to see how the metas are adapting to the scaling with these new, most recent matches. It still feels like all three regions are. Each teams are still busting out new things. There's a lot of strategies and styles I think we're going to be privy to see, even at DreamHack alone, right? I think teams will be busting out crazy new pocket strats. Maybe it's the rise of Hammer. Maybe it's the rise of Stitches. Like, it could, you never know in these kind of patches because it's such a different patch. But do we have any Reddit questions? Because we've covered all our topics. It's a little early. But
it wouldn't be too big of a deal if we ended early. Athero's got a bus to catch.
Yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, I know. We got to fly to DreamHack to go win some esports money. Yeah, I just want to just talk about DreamHack really quick. That event was like planned really last minute, but just hats off to DreamHack in general for being an organization that like just really wants to be involved in Heroes. They did what, three events? They did what, Valencia? And they didn't have it at Summer or London, but there's been three DreamHacks, right, Athero? Maybe it was before your time.
Before I even started playing.
Damn, dude, you're such... It's ridiculous how good you are at the game, considering how young of a player you are. Yeah, so there were three DreamHacks, and now they've... I think it was all sponsored by Turtle Beach, but basically they didn't have a sponsor for it, and now they've managed to get a sponsor for Winter, and they're bringing out eight, you know, the best eight European teams to duke it out, and... Just cool to have more brands involved. I'm hopeful that next year we'll have maybe MLG will step into Heroes, right? Maybe like actually step into Heroes, not just Titan Arena, because that was like an MLG funded thing on their platform, but that wasn't actually MLG running Titan Arena.
I'm curious as to how far they're willing to branch out with this DreamHack, because I think I talked about it last week, but we were invited to play into this tournament. I'm curious if we are the only like non-European team. Did they go to C9? Did they go to any of the Korean or Chinese teams to try and get them out? Because like right now, this just looks like a normal European DreamHack. But this was like the first DreamHack where foreigner teams were invited to.
Yeah.
Which is like that makes it that just ups the scale of the event a whole lot more. I'm curious if they went out to more teams or not. Because like if like maybe like two of these teams were dropped and suddenly you had like you know C9 and Tempo or like maybe one of the Korean Chinese teams there like that. I'm just curious as to how big they were wanting the event to be.
Yeah, another big shout out to Enter the Storm. They're doing a lot for the game. Expanding to America is a big deal. In general, it feels like Europe has a little bit more opportunity right now. But with Enter the Storm, you know, branching out to America, that gives a lot more opportunity for players. And that's what we need more of. I mean, even myself, I'm trying to figure out more events for the community. So hopefully we can get that more stuff rolling very soon. Even just, you know, maybe bring back Kings of the Storm with a prize pool. If I can get the sponsors, that'll be a thing. That's the goal. Looking at Reddit, anything interesting?
We actually think we covered all the topics.
We did, all the questions.
For the most part, yeah. Some questions about Cho'Gall, Cloud9, what new heroes are good in this patch, and I think we covered most of that.
All right, well, then we can move on over to shout-outs, starting with you, Zoloff.
Shout-out to Tempestorm, for giving us the house, and all our sponsors, Twitch, and Namecheap, and G2A. So big shout-out to those guys for making all of our dreams possible. We're going through roster changes, guys. Just keep the faith open. I know we're not playing anything right now. Right now, our only focus is getting the best possible roster and being as patient as possible with it. Even if we find this guy person feels like a perfect fit, we're still trying out every possible option that we think has a chance. And, we're going to be very patient with it. We're going to keep you guys updated, but... we're at least not signing people till January, which is over a month away from now. Keep cheering us on. We're not going anywhere. If you are still wanting Tempo Storm in your life, go to tempestorm.com. We release articles every single day for Heroes of the Storm, as well as we branch into Overwatch as well. So we're releasing Overwatch articles there now as well. YouTube.com/TempoStormHeroes. Starting next week, we'll be producing content as the four of us for now. There'll be a lot more content coming specifically from me. And then, of course, you'll have the continued Dread, KO, and Soldier content as well. Esports Arena, it's happening in January. Myself and Gillyweed are casting it. It's going to hopefully be an international LAN where Na'Vi and Dignitas do end up getting flat out if the prize pool is reached. But we're doing a Kickstarter campaign for it. We're also casting the qualifier for it, which is taking place December 4th and 5th, or 5th and 6th, one of the two. But Gilly and I will be casting the final day of the qualifier. It's a two-day qualifier. We'll be casting the final day to make sure you check that out. And that's it for me. Oh, you can follow me at Zoya TV on Twitch. That's coming back in full force, boys.
Nice.
Easy peasy.
Kubis.
Twitch and Twitter, at the Kubi. Really looking forward to DreamHack this weekend. And seeing a little bit more of that Bob Ross fan club. So good luck to both of you guys in your competitions this weekend. I'll be watching. And thanks to you guys so much for coming on. Make sure you give these guys a follow. I see you guys don't have too many followers on Twitter. I know you guys would like to have more, so give these guys a follow. Other than that, we'll see you guys next week.
Damn, just calling them out.
Yeah.
Fraudulent players. McIntyre, fraudulent number one.
Oh, what?
I guess a shout out to my new teammates. I know that they're probably farming mats in Vanilla WoW at the moment so that they can raid later this week. But cheers for them giving me an opportunity to play with such good players. Shout outs, I guess, to my family and my girlfriend for supporting me through this long period of wait. I haven't been on a team in a while, so they've kind of just been helping me through that. Also, my stream, all my viewers, my subs, my three mods, Ballsy, Esquire, and Turd.
You've only got three mods?
Turd Burger, yeah. And then I guess bringing up my stream, like McIntyre Lol is my Twitch. Obviously, my Twitter, McIntyre Hods, I don't have any followers. I guess you guys should follow me according to Kubi. I also have a tier list too on my stream. If you guys are trying to gain rankings in Hero League, coming from the number one NA player on the leaderboards,
Just saying, I might know a thing or two, so you should swing by and check that out as well, as well as my YouTube channel. I have some insightful videos there, but that does it for me. So again, thank you guys. Cheers for having me on tonight. Yeah, that's me.
All right, Ethero.
Shouts to Dignitas, all the sponsors, OD, and specifically Meth for helping us with the transfers. Shoutouts to all the people that after BlizzCon were like came up to us and were like, we were shouting or we were cheering for you, even though there was like two of us in the crowd. Follow me on Twitter and Twitch. They're both the same handle, EtherAngel. And yeah, I hope we can do pretty well at DreamHack.
Well, best of luck at DreamHack. I'll be watching. DreamHack, of course, is Thursday, Friday this week. So if you live in America, that is Thanksgiving, and you will need to abandon your family to watch the tournament. Fortunately, Europe is ahead of us, so hopefully you can catch the action earlier in the morning before you celebrate your dinner. Thanks for coming on, guys. Ethero, best of luck. McIntyre, because of you, I have to do this. Grudgingly, thank you to all my mods for being so hardworking. Actually, you guys really are. Not grudgingly, you guys are actually awesome. Without
name
you.
Name them.
Yeah, name them all.
I can't name all my mods.
Name all the mods.
No, name all the mods.
Name all the mods.
We'll be here a while.
Hashtag
you
waffle.
You don't have that many mods.
Hashtag waffle.
I actually do have
hashtag good. Waffle.
Hashtag waffle in the
you
chat.
Just name the mods.
Wait, why is McIntyre mod? See, like, this is why I can't name all my mods.
Yeah, you mod everyone that you've ever met.
Name them.
Half the players are mods. Town Hall will be back next week, but we are going to be setting the date for Town Holiday. We'll be announcing that next week. That will be in December. Like I said last week, at the end of December, we will have two-week break, and that will be it. Oh, wow. List all my mods. I'm not reading that list. It's so long, Elsana.
Read the list.
Why is like I'm going to demod half these people now that I'm looking at this list.
Hashtag that's not awkward. Even all of them. That's just everyone through F.
Yeah, I've been
you
told.
You fraud.
Jeez.
I'm still a mod if he starts removing people from that list. Let's go.
Anyways. That is going to be it for the episode. We'll see you next time.
You gave Miwa mod out of all people, Miwa. Really?